So to start off, I just wanted to just have some space open for anyone who wanted to share any experiences, any dreams, or anything that came up for them. So we'll check in.
And you want to just open or
yeah.
Go around?
No, you just open. Yeah, it's not. Yeah. It's where we want to share.
Share first I listened to Whitney on the ride home, of course. I had to do that. And then the fire ceremony last night really reminded or you know brought me back to being at Standing Rock. And it'll be the anniversary of my father's passing, 5-year anniversary this month, in about a week and a half. So I was inspired to consider maybe having like a more than 24-hour fire as part of that moment. So I'm really grateful for that. You know, also, some of what we talked about last night was just the journey of Cabilio and how a lot of it started at Standing Rock energetically and spiritually. So that just feels really full circle. And then like there's always a lot happening in community, but last night I had a really powerful conversation with another Cabilio member that felt very healing. And then I slept really well. I don't remember my dreams, but I woke up and I looked right at my ancestor altar and just felt, I just didn't feel distance. You know, I just felt like, oh, y'all are still here. Like, you're still here. And that was all right.
Yeah. daily thing. Like, why wouldn't it be balanced with joy, which is harder for me? I've been practicing that. And I'm really drawn to the idea of having someone who is, like, a guide who is supporting me. I don't think I have that. And it would be so helpful.
Did not go to the fire yesterday. I went, quote unquote, home. I'm being hosted by Alex and Marina, and there were a few things that I wanted to do, talking to people and doing some things in order to set up certain things when I come back home and in order to have certain things ready. In general, going through some health situations, and back home working in a new way that I never have before, being supported by people in my community, and so there were some things that I wanted to do. But I say that in terms of this tension or this pull between kind of being an individual and being part of a group has been long on my mind, as well as fitting in or not fitting in, as well as I've been in hermit mode. You know, I kind of during this pandemic, a lot of people were freaking out and this and that, and that. Part of the way I moved through it was like, yo, I'm going in a hermit mode. You know, so I just kind of claimed it and kind of moved through with it and, you know, kind of used the time in isolation and things like that. But I guess this weekend, it's kind of like, what would it be like to have, you know, you talk about cooperative living and things like that. Like, what would it be like to even you were talking about to have people closer to me, you know, to have people closer to me in a way that feels good, in a way that feels like we're moving together, and feels, and so that's kind of, you know, it's kind of like the space that I'm looking for or struggling with, or even in my religious community, there's a lot of individual, there's a lot of ways in which it's a quote-unquote individual spiritual practice. You know, we're kind of struggling, like, what does it mean to be a communal practice? We're kind of, like, struggling with that. When do we get together? How do we get together? Stuff like that. So I think that in a way, I'm glad that I kind of, like, took the time to meet my own needs, stuff like that, but it's also like, if I do that all the time, am I just always pulling away from everybody? Am I part of, you know, how do I connect with people and stuff like that if I always pull away to meet my needs? So these are the things that have kind of been floating around, and then I really liked it. So far, so good. So, you know, I was telling them I've been exposed to other types of Buddhism, other ways that people do Buddhist things. Is there something? I won't go into details. My best friend, my very good best friend, anyway. Different sandals with different styles. I see it very clearly. activities and rituals and doing work and stuff like that. So I didn't know what to expect, but I hope to be around and see how it, you know, see what happens in the future. So thank you.
Yeah, it's exciting. Everything. Everything's exciting. I should have said this yesterday. So, for those of you who are new to Buddhism, this isn't normal. To like say that more now because I get brand new people and they're like, oh my god, Buddhism is really cool. I don't know if this is all Buddhism happening. So just to put that out there, I would say it's Buddhist-y.
I appreciate that feeling. I also want to speak to that from the place that I feel like I come from, which is not identifying as Buddhist, not being Buddhist, appreciating Buddhist, having it in my ancestral lineage too, but having other things too. Christianity being a big part of it, not wanting to turn away from that, even though it's not. And yesterday I heard you know, a kind of us versus them, at least it, that's how it landed on me, with secular and not secular. And so I feel like I occupy, in my life too, first generation immigrant, daughter of immigrants, always an in-between space. And often on the edge too. And I don't use the term secular, but there is a place that I've experienced deep and profound and sacred holding in what most people would call a secular mindfulness by very profound teachers. And I also see the commercialization of it. I couldn't have walked through the door of Buddhism without that, because the Buddhist faces in this culture here in this country felt closed to me. And in my culture growing up, it was also very culturally held, right? It's hard to explain, but being different ethnic groups, you weren't necessarily welcomed into a Buddhist community that was. And in this country, I've also experienced a lot of harm from Buddhist institutions. So I don't know what the word is, but what is another word? I'm trying to find that too in holding spaces. I don't want to call it, I can't call it Buddhist because I don't come with any authority for that, but I also don't want to call it not a secular. And I just wonder whether there is some room for something else other than the this or that. Something that holds a mystery. And I hope you heard me say that I deeply appreciate this, what you're offering.
Absolutely. Well, I think a lot other people in the space feel the same way. Pretty sure, actually. But it's, I mean, why do you have to name anything? You know, it's so much of this. There's a principle, which I've already mentioned, in Tantra that maybe creating and putting out there, but I think it's still there. Fierceness, you know, which I'm writing about in the new book, which is not what you're gonna, it's nothing that you expect. Like, don't even think you know it's coming out in the next book. It is way out there, and this is why I think this is really important. Like, I'm writing a book that I don't even know what the book is, like, where to put it. It's not Buddhist. It's also some Christianity in it. It's some magic. It's a lot of stuff. And I'm like, I'm not calling it anything except a book. this fierceness that I've been thinking about, it's a fierceness that, in a way, demands that the world shapes itself around me. Kind of like the Matrix. Like, I have to be really boundaried here because I can go down a path for the next hour about the Matrix. I will just say this, that point in the Matrix where Neo... That's all I'm going to say about it. Where Neo, like, wakes up and is like, oh, like, I can bend myself around the bullet instead of whatever, you know? Or he actually, no, sorry, he stops the bullet, sorry. Like, he's like, no, I'm no longer going to bend myself around the bullets. I'm just going to stop it, you know? Like, I'm not going to, so really what this translates into is that, like, I'm going to no longer try to force myself to fit in to these categories. I'm just going to be. That's really what that lesson is. Like, I'm just going to start being, right? And then things shift. Like, so you're not so interested in trying to figure out labels, you know? And that's, you know, liberation work, like, it goes off the tracks in that way. Into territory that you can't name or describe because, like, that's what freedom is. Freedom is a blurring, you know? It's not about categories and all this stuff. It's just about a being, right? And it's really uncomfortable. It's a lot of, it can be suffering, you know? Or it can be this point of, like, deep inspiration and insight. But the fierceness piece is that I know who I am and I know what I'm doing. And I may not know how to describe it, but I'm confident in what's happening. And this confidence, well, I'm confident because I know what it's opening up for me. I know that, like, I am experiencing liberation slowly, but I am experiencing it bit by bit. And that's the data that we get back that encourages us to continue. You know, I love God, you know, right? And that doesn't make me less of anything else. Like, it doesn't mean that, like, I have the same understanding of God that other people have. It means that, like, you know, there's something, there's an experience there that's helping me to be free. And I just do it, you know? I can love God, I can love the mother, right? You know? So anyway.
Of my mom's kneecaps breaking last night. And Alice was like, you should
how could I even share this that long? Well, here I am on the tape recorder, so. And I don't know what any of it means, but I need to, I don't want to turn back and get stuck there. So I don't know what my point is. I think my point is that I don't have the confidence yet, and so that's where this all this emotion is, because there's such a longing. And I do feel like right now the ancestors are so intensely like sucking me back in. And I want to find the strength to be like, no. I don't know what violence is going to erupt from that. And so that's really scary. And I also like, if I say no, I think it's so, I'm starting to think, I can say no and burst into tears, but still say no. Like, I have this image of when you say no, it's like, no. And I'm like, I think I'm just going to say no, and you're like, no. So, I see you nodding, so it seems like that's okay. Okay, so if I can have your prayers and your willing then for all of you, that would mean a lot, because it's really scary right now for me. I mean, for lots of people, but in this case, thank you.
If we give everything over to the mother. I'm a little thing here. Everything to the mother. I just saw Sadani gave it to me. I keep it in a Ziploc bag so it'll get dirty. It's a napkin, it's a handkerchief. Yeah, everything to the mother. Like, this is, you get to this point where, like, I don't know. So I offer, you know, to the mother, to Chenrezig, to the earth, to the fire, right? This one we call for help. This one we're like, we ask for help, and we give it over, you know? You know, it's not like you're just giving up your work. It's, I think it's a really profound way that we're cutting through fixation and getting back to the space. And that space is gonna like actually show us what to do, but we can't get there because we're so contracted around the anxiety, the sadness, the fear, the worry. That's why we give it over, to open up the space again, so I know how to respond, you know? And I get trapped.
Ask a question?
Yeah.
So when you give it over, does that mean you stop thinking about it?
I mean, like, it's hard not to.
Uh-huh.
Like, it's something that you just keep doing over and over again. So you just don't do it once, right?
Yeah.
You know, just give it over. It's like when you feel that, you know, whenever the discomfort is, you're like, okay, I offer this. And you let go. And of course it may build up again, you just keep offering it. You know, and the space opens up more and more, right? And then you see other kind of paths forward that you couldn't see, right? If you were still holding on to that suffering. Yeah. And this is one of the things that we encounter on the path. It's like the ways in which we just have to keep moving forward and not turn back. You know? That's one of the heartbreaking parts of liberation. Too, it's like also that you have to leave people. Because not everyone's ready to get free, not everyone's trying to get free, you know? And then you say, okay, like I have to do this, you know, for myself. You know? And not that like people are going to be left behind forever. It's that the bodhisattva path is that I'm going to get to a certain level, and then I'll have the capacity to return to get you, and I won't be lost. You know, like Harriet Tubman, you know, who had to get free and then started to return back, you know, into to plantations to free people, right? But she had to awaken to her own capacity to free people before she could go back and free others. And that's why I think this is what you're doing. It's like you're deepening your capacity to be this agent of liberation, but you're still in the process of getting to a certain level of freedom that will make it possible for you to actually turn back and not get lost in the turning back to help people. So this is a natural place to be, I think. You have to get, you know, like, there's a kind of brokenheartedness that we have to experience for the world and for people. Like, it's just, you have to get to this place where you get what this is. Like, this isn't your home. This isn't anyone's home. Right? And that people are stuck and wandering in the cycle. And you start waking up to that, right? And there's a deep sadness, you know, that others aren't doing it, aren't waking up. And that starts propelling you, motivating you to be a change, agent of change, liberation. It's not arrogance or pity or anything. It's this, like, deep commitment. Like, you see yourself as others. Like, I may be free, but as long as other beings are bound, how free can I be? Yeah. And it's tough, you know, we come out of tough ancestry. You know, a lot of us do. We're like, I'm not going to deal with this. Like, this is not who I am. It's not who I am, right? You know? So you set the boundaries and say, this isn't who I am anymore. Right? As I always say, too, you talk about ancestors. Like, yeah, we may have ancestors that really created a lot of harm. But sometimes those same ancestors realize that they did create harm and want to change. And they see you as someone to ally with. So that's why when people say I don't want to deal with my ancestors, where they're ancestors who, like, you're the only person that's gonna help them. You know, that can help them. Like, people change. You know, death is a great change agent, you know? And not all the time, right? Like, it doesn't, like, not everyone passes on and changes and, like, oh my God, I really fucked up, you know? So, it doesn't always happen, you know? But sometimes it does, often enough, you know? And you can be that living, you know, agent in your ancestral mind that can be like, okay, let's start doing something different. You know, and this is for all of us. You know, when you want to get into ancestor practice, one of the things that we start doing is thinking about how do we offer back to our ancestors the things that they didn't have. Mm-hmm. You know, like, I don't know, whatever it is, joy or knowledge or something, you know, like when you, this is like a sympathetic joy practice, which is like when I experience something transformative, I just offer it back to my ancestors. And I invite them to take part in it, to to share this experience that I'm having. And that's how you start a lot of healing in your ancestry. When you just open like that and say, here, like, enjoy, take this joy, right? I'm eating this really great meal. Take this enjoyment. You know, may you enjoy this meal as well through me. You know? If you can be done with sex, it's a really great way to do this. May you enjoy this. You know? May you tune into my body in a way that you couldn't tune into yours when you were alive. Then you start working together, and a lot of great things can start happening. Because the ancestors have things that they can offer us that can really help us move through life. They have sights and, you know, insight and perspectives that we don't have. And if you tune into them, they offer that. Mm-hmm. And then you become a more powerful ancestor when you transition. Because you did that, you had that connection in life. I mean, we don't really, you know, like in traditional Buddhist spaces, we don't really talk like this. Dare I say this came from somewhere else? This is what I practice, so.
I don't care where it came from.
Huh? What's that? Yeah, that's right. If it sounds good, I'm doing it. You know.
I have a question in addition to that. Thank you for your sharing. It made me, you know, I have this, I feel like I'm in diapers when it comes to understanding, you know, personal relationship with ancestors and relationship with the earth. And I get hung up in offering pain and asking for help, because I often think, you know, if I love these beings, if I love this planet, I'm not going to offer my pain to it. And I have a mentor who said, you know, that the earth wants your pain, like she's the ultimate composter.
Yeah.
And so by not giving in, you know, you're keeping her, like, what she's wanting.
Yeah.
And it's really hard for me to get to that place. And not surprising that, you know, pain is in my body, because it's like this, I don't always know how to let go.
Yeah.
And I don't know how to let go. And ask for help in that way, in those moments.
Yeah.
And so when you're saying, like, offering wonderful things, that's something that I definitely connect with.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, here's the tantric view on this. So, like, you can, like, you know, so much ritual, tantric rituals, offering, mental offerings, like flowers, incense, water, stuff like that, food, which is really traditional in the practices. So if I'm visualizing Chenrezig and I'm doing these offerings, do you think Chenrezig actually sees flowers and whatever I offer? Like, is that what they're resonating? Are they happy because they're getting flowers? You know? But what's the nature of that kind of offering? Anything, any offering. Be it pain or pleasure or flowers, like, what's the nature of it? You know, it's energy. It's energy that I have a certain relationship with, but an awakened being has a different relationship with.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I may offer pain, but that's not what they're getting.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're getting like a, they're getting like this energy. It's like energy that I'm offering from my experience that I have a complicated relationship with. you're not hurting. Like, you're, the pain that you're offering energetically isn't like violence. It's not like you're gonna hurt, it's just energy. And a consciousness, a massive awakened consciousness, that's like, that energy is like adding a drop of water to the ocean. Like, it's really not that. It really isn't. And that's because we don't like understand the massiveness of consciousness, right? It's like, for us, this is like intense and big, mm-hmm. but an awakened consciousness is like, oh, it's just a drop in the boundless ocean of energy. So you're not going to overwhelm me. Yeah. But I think it's natural. I think it's natural when we talk about the earth. I get this all the time, too, where it's like, oh, I'm going to hurt the earth. You know, because we see the hurt. Like, you see and feel it. But that's because of a misunderstanding of relationship to the earth. But when we offer it to the earth like this, that's a right relationship that's coming into balance.
Yeah, and in that there's vulnerability, which, you know, is feels unsafe.
Yes.
Because I'm saying, I actually need you.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. In this moment, you know, and so there is a...
Well, that's how you start cutting through ego as well, when you open up to help.
Yeah.
And that's how liberation work is propelled, sped up, when we ask for help, and when we start relying on other beings and the natural world and so forth. Right. Yeah, that's incredible work, too. You know, then that's what we're returning back to, is that kind of relationship, not just the earth, but all the elements and so forth. Okay. Well, let's, if there's no one else would like to share, we can just transition into a little bit of practice. And so, working with the practice, so much of what's come up in the sharing has been about vulnerability, I think, and when this practice kind of started awakening in me, it was really interesting to see like Chenrezig and fire brought together, you know? And there's so much about the element of fire that's related to love and compassion and care, you know, general energies we're working with. And there's something about letting the fire burn away, you know, what we struggle with. We offer to the fire, right? Offering to the fire, letting it burn, you know, ring the fire. And around the heart, you know, and let the fire really sink in and surrender to it. If there's despair, hopelessness, fear, just offer all of that to the fire. The fierceness of the heart, let it consume it, and let it go deep. You know, these are the kinds of practices where I just kind of let myself go, because I've gotten to a point where I trust that I'm going to be calm.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that I can step off that ledge into the practice and I'm going to be okay, right? But the holding back, I mean, the holding back is something that we all have to wrestle with. Like, and I would be surprised if you're not, you know, wrestling with that. But to just let go, right? Because this kind of liberation, particularly this ultimate liberation, is so much about just, it's a trust fall, right? The trust fall is going to outpace the ego, right? So you're moving faster than the ego can keep up with you, you know? And it may just be a split second that you're outside, but that's enough, actually. That's really enough, you know? Because you start remembering. Like, if you get that taste of egolessness, like, that's all you need. That's really one of the principal parts of our practice. Like, Tantra is like, yeah, we want to get free, but, you know, let's settle for a glimpse of freedom so you know what it is. Like, if you know what freedom is, you'll never be confused again. Right? Like, I'll tell this story, and then we'll start. You know, this is, like, my favorite story. I don't tell this often anymore, but this is about ice cream. When I was young, I ended up going to Europe on a school trip. And I never, it was my first experiences with a lot of things, being in another country that young. And I was just kind of homesick. This is the 90s. I was like, oh, I don't want to be here. I was in Paris, you know. It was overwhelmed. Like, it was just dirty, and, you know, too many people, and I didn't speak the language. And I came from a small southern town. Right, and all of a sudden I was in Paris. It was just overwhelming. I was like completely shut down. I wanted to go home, you know. And it was a school trip, so it was a bunch of young people, right? And a couple of us went to this cafe, and I ordered ice cream, you know. And I got this ice cream. I'd never forget. It was in a little metal dish. With this like vanilla wafer in it, and I ate the ice cream, and I swear I never had something that good in my life, and it changed my whole trip. I literally was like, "Oh my god, this isn't a bad place," and that, my friend, sparked my obsession with travel. But that's also important because I will never forget what that experience was. Like, I've been chasing that experience. You know, I've been back to that same spot in Paris, like, several times looking for that coffee. Like, literally, like, I'm like, where was that coffee? Shit. But I think that's so important because, I will never forget that. Like, I know what the best ice cream in my life tastes like. In the same way, when we get a glimpse of freedom, we will never forget it. Like, you will never forget it, right? And that's going to guide you deeper into authentic experiences of freedom. Not just in this life, but in your transition out of this life. Like, if you can remember what freedom is, then there's a greater possibility that you will be freed in the transition. You know, what we call the bardo, which is the, you know, transition through the after-death experience, right? And that's, you know, it's really all you need, you know? I may not get free in this life, but I'm pretty definite I can get a glimpse or a taste of what it is. And you carry it. It's not, literally, it's nothing you will forget in your lives to come. Like, you'll know what it is. This is why you're here. Like, this is why many of you seek out spiritual practices and communities and so forth. You know, that's why we seek out, like, plant medicine, you know? Because, like, that memory is embedded in our consciousness. And so when we're reborn, like, we're just, like, seeking it out in ways that we may not even be conscious of, but we're moving towards it, you know? I mean, it's you know, for me, you know, when I was introduced to Buddhism, you know, well, when when I, like, well, yeah, I would say that, like, my whole life was always being directed towards freedom in ways that I wasn't even conscious of, right? When Buddhism showed up, I was like, oh, you know? That's something that, like, can really, really propel me deeper into this, right? So you know what it is. Like, you know what it is. And we can't name it, but we know it. Of course, Buddhism would argue that all beings, right, all sentient beings are trying to have that faint of memory of freedom somewhere, right? But it's there. You know, for us, it's even stronger. You know, we say seekers. You know? Like, we already know so many people don't even know what they're seeking. They're just, like, on this path. Right? And you don't have to name it. You know, this whole idea of Buddhism doesn't exist. Mm. You know, like, this doesn't exist in, I would say, the spirit world, Bardo. You know? This is just something that's happening in the relative, right, to help us make sense of the universe, our emptiness, the nature of things. But even this idea of Buddhism has to be offered up in order to experience ultimate liberation. Anyway, let's start practice. Let's do a little practice. So this is going to be recorded. And so we'll have the recording for you to explore. And again, you know, there's a couple of plans that we have, but definitely in October, we want us to start having maybe a monthly gathering. You know, there will be other people initiated to this practice next week as well, some teaching at this winter retreat. So the community for this practice is growing. And I'll be away in September anyway, trying to get free in retreat. So, and I'll be back in October. But anyway, we talked about the vase breath yesterday, which will be one of the breaths. And I'm going to teach it just in a really, like, simple way, not in the super traditional way, where it takes a lot of, like, posture and alignment. But I think you can get there with just a more informal. It's still a holding of the breath, concentrating energy in the lower part of the body, lifting the pelvic floor. And holding that. So you're creating a stop, you know. So it's, I was just like giving instructions for the breath, so when we start the practice, I won't slow down doing this. But so it's inhaling and filling up from the very bottom of the diaphragm. You don't want to fill up, you don't have to fill up completely, but to a place that feels appropriate and you can hold it. And then you stop, you pull up the pelvis floor, and then swallow. Feeling saliva just sink down into the throat. And that's creating this illusion of something that's contained. The pelvic floor is up, the throat is sealed by the saliva. So you're getting this vision of air and prana just being held in the lower diaphragm. You know, often teachers talk about this feeling of, like, it's like a basketball in your stomach, right? You start to feel that roundness in the lower stomach and diaphragm, right? And so that's the mechanics, the physical mechanics. So breath in, raising the pelvic floor, swallowing, and holding. you just hold for as long as it feels okay, and then release it. So again, prana and the breath ride together. So you're holding the breath and you're holding prana in the lower stomach and diaphragm. And of course you'll experience certain physical and maybe mental things as well. So that's the mechanics of the breath. And the visualization, right, is that there's a flame in the solar plexus, which is around the navel. So it's in the body. And so there's a flame, a candle flame, right? And so it's really being held in the center, you know, of this breath that we're holding, or the roundness of the breath in the lower stomach, diaphragm. And so we'll do that a few times, right? And in the visualization, you're going to imagine that the flame gets stronger with each holding. And some of you may actually begin to warm up as well. But again, this isn't like a mandatory part of the practice. So I'm just going through it. So we'll start at the beginning again in a couple of minutes with the full practice. But so I don't have to like stop and do this when we get into the practice. So you'll be familiar with it, okay? So after a couple of breaths, the flame intensifies. It's not filling up the space, but maybe it gets like maybe 3 or 4 times bigger. So literally the size of a flame, an actual flame, you know, from a candle. You want to start that small and then grow it. Maybe another, you know, maybe 6 inches, you know, not huge. Like you're not being engulfed. The fire in your tummy. Right. And so once the flame grows, we let go of the breath, come back to our natural breath. And we begin to imagine that kind of streams of flame begin to kind of rise up into the heart, right? And I don't want to get too complicated with it either. But for me, it's the flame, these streams of flames are circling around the central column, right? That runs along parallel to the spine. And so if you practice Kundalini, it's very similar, like how the snakes encircle themselves around the central column up through the body. So the flames are just circling around the central column up to the heart. Where they start entering into the heart, warming the heart up. So we're working with the heart center and imagining that the heart is actually in the center of the chest. You know, in the heart chakra. And then the heart begins to glow, you know, because of this infused energy. And then slowly we begin to imagine that the flame, that same flame from this, from the flame in the third chakra, that same flame that's gone to the heart center begins to reemerge and begins to circle around the heart, getting to this first ring of fire. And it's okay if you begin to feel some like sensation, I would say, in the heart chakra area, because this is, the heart chakra is being worked out. It's like a workout. And, you know, and that's where we can just stop there, like that's, because the rest is something that's really simple to continue with. But I want to go back to the very beginning and really build the practice up now. Let's take a short break, and then we'll do it, and then we'll be done by 12. So let's do a 5-minute break. And I can get ready too. the second, yeah, the second chakra is traditionally done, but I want to start a little higher.
Gotcha.
Yeah, and around the navel. Yeah. Kundalini starts at the root chakra, so it's like it varies depending on the tradition. So I want to start with the heat, you know, but people weren't clear even in like in Tibetan side, it still wasn't clear about where it is.
That's helpful, right?
Yeah.
Don't get caught up in the exact location.
Yeah, you can't in like energy sciences like this. It's approximate. It's like all approximate, like, you know. So it comes with this feeling, like it's everyone beginning to feel into like where things are happening, where energy seems to be moving and awakening.
Can you talk about the pelvic floor? Are you referring to a physical action or
Kegels?
Yeah.
The what now?
Like Kegels? Like
yeah.
You...
Well, so it's both a it's a physical and a mental thing. Like it's we want to believe that something's closing and keeping, like stopping up the bottom, keeping the prana from flowing out. So then we say, oh, let's like figure out a muscle or something that we can activate that can give us the illusion of closing.
Because it's like in Qigong, like the lower gate.
Yes,
like,
yeah. What is, it's there's another muscle, like not, sphincter, yeah, like that kind of like feeling of just closing, tightening, right, and figuring out that for your body, yeah. But again, you're not really like it's not physically closing. You're just trying to believe, like because prana is like a mental, it's a mental thing, and so you just want to, if you can believe it. And the prana shapes itself around belief.
Mm.
You know, not so much this action of closing. Like, you can't really close the bottom, the body out. But you can create energetic closing if you can just believe that, that you're doing that.
And the muscle, actually contracting the muscle helps support the belief.
Yeah. Yeah. Just like when, so swallowing, I mean, this. Saliva isn't going to close your throat off, right? But it's just the feeling that, oh, like something's being stopped. You know? And so that creates the illusion of a kind of pressurized experience there, right? And over time, the more you work with it, the more it's like, oh, yeah. Okay, I can actually, like, contain prana if I can just believe I can, which is magic, you know. So we're gonna do that breath, the base breathing, just three times. But again, this is just approximate things. And so over time, you begin to understand what your limits are and how deep you want to go with them. You know, but in those three holdings. You know, you're just allowing the flame in the third, in the navel area, third chakra, to grow, you know? And that's like the pilot light, you know? You know, like this is the pilot light. And, you know, for those of you who are at the fire, you know, going back to the flame that we took energetically and revisiting that, because that's in your consciousness now. You know, that's actually what we call fire medicine. You know, when you collect the energy essence of something, that's this whole medicine. You know, that's what medicine bags are for. And, you know, well, this is a mental consciousness based medicine bag. But you go around collecting the essence of plants and elements, and that becomes part of how you work, how you do medicine work, right? Animal medicine, stone medicine, you know. There's lots to talk about, lots to say, just don't have the time. So many things, okay? So we're gonna, yeah, let's get started again. So I'm just gonna start from the very beginning. So we're just gonna build it up from the very beginning again. But you have the basic elements now. All right? So always checking in with your body. Allowing the body to be at ease. And checking in with intentions. Why am I doing this? And who do I hope to benefit from this practice? Continue again just by calling yourself back into the space. If we're wondering in the past or wondering in the future, calling yourself back, noticing the weight of your body as an anchor to call yourself back. And again, noticing the earth, right? Turning our attention to the earth, our attention being energy, a conscious energy that we direct into the earth, which is an expression of a massive awakened consciousness. And in this connection and noticing, really asking the earth in this moment just to hold us, to anchor us as we journey into this practice. And this is what I call a safeguard for the practice. When we connect with the earth is going to do its job to hold us. So whenever we feel like we're just lost and wondering, we just turn our attention back to the earth and the earth is holding us. Or we just ask the earth to find us and the earth will find us. Continue by calling to the space, our benefactors, our homecoming circle, calling our guides and teachers and elders and deities, saints, and so forth. they begin to form a circle around us. We have a sense that they've gathered. We turn our attention to, again, reflecting on the energy of love in the universe. That love holds everything. We can slowly begin to imagine that our homecoming circle begins to collect and absorb this love from the universe. They absorb so much of this love energy that they begin to glow around you. And it seems as if they are glowing so intensely that they form a ring, a glowing red ring around you. This ring again is the intensity of love that our benefactors have collected for us. And they slowly begin to radiate this intense energy into our third chakra. Our solar plexus, which is right around our navel. And this energy forms a flame, just a, like a candle flame, right in the solar plexus, right in the central channel. So it seems as if there's a flame in this hollow cylinder that's running up parallel to the spine into our heart centers. So once we have a sense of this flame being ignited, we begin to transition to our base breathing. So working at your own pace, your own speed, you begin to breathe deeply down into the diaphragm as if a ball is forming in the bottom part of our diaphragm. And once that ball is full, we pull up our pelvic floor and we swallow to close off that collected ball of prana and breath. And holding that intensity for a couple of seconds, imagining that that flame grows, it doubles its size. And when you're ready, gently releasing the breath. And then moving to the breath two more times. Each time, the flame doubles in size. And then finishing up the third breath. And noticing how this flame has grown in the third chakra in the solar plexus. Coming back to a normal breath if you haven't already, natural breath. And when you're ready, beginning to imagine that two streams of fire begin to lift and rise out of the flame. And it begins to circle and intertwine within the central channel, moving up into the heart center. The heart center begins to collect and absorb the energy of this fire into itself. And in the heart center, we can also imagine our actual hearts, you know, an energetic expression of our physical hearts. Also being filled with these streams of fire. And the heart begins to glow as it fills with this energy, it begins to glow and radiate. You know, a red light. Even at this point, we can practice just offering, you know, what we're really struggling with right now into the intensity of this energy in the heart center. Slowly we begin to imagine that a stream of fire leaves the heart center, enters out from the heart center, exits the heart, begins to encircle the heart. The circle of fire continues to burn away the things again that we struggle with, the obstacles that keep us from loving and experiencing love. It's burning away our fear, hopelessness, despair, confusion. It's awakening the heart center, awakening the energy, the fierceness. And I surrender to this fire, this sacred fire, which is the fierceness of Chenrezig. And as we continue working with this part of the practice, we open into our mantra practice as well. And you can chant along or just sit and listen and work with the practice. So, slowly letting the light from the heart center and from the ring of fire, letting that light really radiate throughout the body. Filling the body with this fierce, loving energy, the essence of the consciousness of Chenrezig. Bodies fill up so much and get so intense that our physical bodies begin to transform into the expression, the emanation of Chenrezig. You say to yourself, I am Chenrezig. I am the embodiment of love, of liberation. That all doubt, all fear, hopelessness, anxiety is dissolved within the ocean of my loving consciousness. I am the union of everything. Omani Damehu, the essence is always unified. I am whole. so slowly, you begin to imagine that we, as Chenrezig, slowly began to dissolve into the essence of everything, the emptiness, the space, the energy that is the essence of everything, returning back to this ocean of everything. Until there's only our awakened consciousness left that begins to expand into this ocean. And slowly we begin to re-arise back into this timeline, back into our bodies, back onto the earth, allowing the earth to hold us. Allowing ourselves to come back into movement. Slowly reawakening our bodies, returning breath to the body, and offering gratitude to all the elements of our practice, to all the elements that made our practice possible. So offering gratitude to the earth, into our bodies, into our breath. Offering gratitude to our ancestors and our homecoming circles. Offering appreciation to this community that's gathered to share this profound practice. Offering gratitude to Chenrezig, all the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas and protectors and all the deities and so forth, all the beings who are supporting us in getting free from suffering. We offer gratitude to all of our teachers, guides and mentors and elders. We offer gratitude to our descendants as well. We offer the energy, the merit of this time and this practice out to all beings, to all the members of the community here that couldn't make it for any reason. We offer first to them that they are connected to this practice. And we offer out to all beings as well, that all beings may one day come to seek true, authentic liberation from suffering. and then we all get free as quickly as possible. Thank you so much for your practice, everyone.